everybody. This week in our online permaculture design certificate course, we learned about aquaculture. And probably one of the largest things we can take away from this is the realization that we are not just speaking about fish production, but all the elements that can be involved. For example, of course, fish are involved, but we also spoke about crustaceans, plants, shellfish, reptiles, and mammals, all of which can be productive or destructive elements to a design, which is why we need to understand their purpose and roles within the design and incorporate them appropriately. We did discuss some of the species that can be involved in this design, though of course the list is not comprehensive. So looking at it in reverse, mammals can incorporate things like the manatee or the capybara, which is the largest rodent and is aquatic. Reptiles can include things like turtles, but also alligators and crocodiles. Shellfish includes things like mussels. Plants of all varieties, such as familiar things like rice and lotus and water chestnut, can be incorporated, but there are many other elements as well. Crustaceans, such as shrimp, prawns, and yabbies, and numerous varieties of fish can all be incorporated into this type of system. One unique thing we discussed about aquaculture is that its production is found in the exact opposite place as where we would see it in agriculture. In agriculture, we know that the smaller area that is being worked produces more product per area. But in aquaculture, the larger the area, the more production that we see per area. So to break that down a different way, in agriculture, if we have an acre, we will produce more per square yard than we would in a system that is 200 acres. The amount that we would produce per square yard in 200 acres is less than what we would produce in a 1 acre system per square yard. In an aquaculture system, if we have an area that is a half an acre, we would produce less in a cubic yard than we would produce in a pond or water system that is 10 acres large. The larger body of water produces more per cubic acre. In this chapter, we discussed a lot about making a self-sustainable system where the larger parts of the system, such as the fish or the mammals, can be fed by the rest of the system. For example, if we have algae in our system, that algae feeds zooplankton. And then our zooplankton is going to feed our crustaceans, which we can then trap to feed our fish. Similarly, our edge plants provide the environment and nutrients for our emergent plants, those just inside the water area. Those emergent plants do the same beneficial action for our water plants, and those in turn provide the same elements for our floating plants. All of these things relate back to what we call the chain of life within an aquaculture system. Throughout the rest of this course, we have been talking about how water is essential to a site, because without water, life cannot exist. Now, however, that we're talking about water life, we have to take another approach on the subject and realize that water life cannot exist without a sufficient amount of oxygen. And for that, we talked about different ways to make sure that oxygen is sufficient within the body of water. We talked about making sure that inlet pipes are positioned properly so that it performs an aeration to the water, and also devices that can be created to help aerate the water. But more importantly, we needed to understand how to recognize the signs that oxygen levels are becoming too low in the water, because at that point, we have created a system that is too life abundant for the system in its place. And the more inputs that we have to do, such as bringing in other devices to perform aeration, tells us that we've reached a tipping point and it's probably time to harvest some of the life systems out of the water. One thing that was clear to me as we went throughout this week's course is that pre-planning and thinking ahead of time is important to trying to get these systems right. Just what do we want to try to harvest out of our individual water systems, such as an individual pond, for example? If it's a place that we want to be able to grow products like rice, or if we want to easily be able to drain that pond so that we can harvest the fish more easily later, there are certain design elements to that pond that we need to put into place to make our lives easier down the line. By making our lives easier, we make ourselves more productive with less energy inputs on our behalf, making the system in a whole more sustainable. One example that we covered this week that I really like are methods to feed fish specifically within a system. We talked about how we can have different types of plants. Two examples that were given were the mulberry or the redbud. Each of them has a different type of pest that can then be fed into the pond to feed fish. And at the same time, the plants themselves can be harvested for things like mulch and so on. So we can feed our animals with a plant that is being sustained by the nutrients and water in the system and return the product of that plant, like the mulberries or the worms or the caterpillars, directly into the water to feed the fish so that they can enrich the water and provide the nutrients back to the plant and start that cycle all over again. Next week is our final topic, and it's entitled Nation. And in that, we begin to discuss how we can take permaculture design and employ them in local communities throughout the world and make a more sustainable nation. I look forward to sharing information with you next week about that. I appreciate you watching, and we'll see you next time.